Mă bucur din nou să fiu împreună cu voi în seara aceasta. Înainte de să intru în mesaj, înainte de să schimb limbajul de română în engleză, aș vrea să vă spun despre un lucru care e o foarte mare binecuvântare în viața mea. Și asta este o tabără care o organizăm împreună cu mai multe biserici pe Coasta de Vest. Cu Paul Oniga lucru de mai mulți ani, cu Doru Gurban, cu mai mulți frați și lideri de tineret și păstori de pe Coasta de Vest. Și este vorba despre o tabără numită The Summit. Just like Peniel, if you recall that. And în iunie, o să trimit mai multe informații lui Danny Valian, dar în iunie, 15, 16, 17, 18, să ține tabra asta în Big Bear, deci în Los Angeles. Și vreau numai să vă încurajez, să încurajați copiii voștri să vină și să împărtășim împreună. Eu călătoresc foarte des, foarte, foarte mult. În anul 2015 am fost plecat între 15 și 20 de weekend-uri. Călătoresc prin toate Statele Unite și în România și în alte țări. Și din toate experiențele care le-am avut în ultimele 15 ani, pot să vă mărturisesc că experiențele pe care le-am avut și la Peniel și la The Summer acum, nu le-am mai avut niciunde. Să văd tineri care se predă Domnului și într-un moment Domnul se schimbă. Tineri care au avut adicții și Domnul care se vezi într-un moment Domnul se rupe lanțurile. Tineri care au dorit să fie botezat cu Duhul Sfânt sau de fapt nici nu venit la tabără cu dorința asta, dar Domnul i-a schimbat inima și i-a botezat cu Duhul Sfânt cu vorbire în alte limbi. The evidence of speaking in tongues. Să vă spun de exemplu un eveniment care ni s-a întâmplat. Și în fiecare an e așa. Într-o seară erau mai mulți tineri jos la altar și se ruga și era un tânăr în spate, ne-a mărturisit după. Și a zis, Eddie, zice, eu eram în spate și aveam un migraine, deci un headache foarte grozav. Și a zis că în gândul lui s-a rugat. Și a zis, Doamne, eu vreau să vin la altar și vreau să fiu botezat. Dar în același timp nu vreau să vin și să nu fiu botezat, că mă doare capul de numai și mai bine mă duc și stau jos și mă odihnesc puțin. Dar, Doamne, dacă Tu vrei să mă botez în seara aceasta. O ales un tânăr de la altar, zice, trimite-l pe Mike să vină și să-mi spune că tu vrei. Și să-l vezi pe Mike în momentul ăla, că sare sus în picioare, se întoarce, vine, pune în spate și zice, Andrew, băiatul îl cheamă Andrew, zice, Andrew, this is gonna sound crazy. Dumnezeu mi-a zis că vrea să te botează în seara aceasta dacă vrei să vii la altar. Și să-l vezi pe Andrew, merge jos la altar și sigur, 100% Domnul l-a botezat. Deci am atât de multe mărturii de genul ăsta. Tineri care noaptea au avut vedeni și dimineața când s-au trezit îmi povestește, Edi, uite, așa am avut un vis. Ce crezi că înseamnă? Și s-a auzit pe un alt tânăr care zice, ăla era pentru mine. Într-o altă experiență care am avut împreună cu Paul, după ce s-a terminat programul, s-a terminat rugăciunea, care majoritatea de ori seara se începe laudă, închinare, rugăciune și de multe ori nu mai ajungem la predică. Stăm 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 ore în rugăciune. Mare este Dumnezeu. Și într-o seară eram cu Paul, s-a terminat rugăciunea, era cam pe la 1 dimineața și am mers într-o cameră și mai era un băiat care străduia, a dorit și el să fie botezat cu Duhul Sfânt. Și tot a stat și tot s-a străduit și a zis, mă duc eu în cabana mea și stau acolo și mă rog. Când am auzit eu și Paul, a zis, vinem și noi cu tine. Și am adunat acolo vreo 10-15 tineri să ne rugăm pentru băiatul acest, Johnny din Sacramento. Și în timp ce ne rugam, parcă tot simțeam de la mine că Domnul a vrut să oprim rugăciunea și să stăm de vorbă puțin despre ce înseamnă botezul cu Duhul Sfânt, că era niște lucruri care, misconceptions. Și tot mă gândeam, ziceam, Doamne, oare e de la Tine, nu e de la Tine, vreau să fiu sigur, nu vreau să opresc rugăciunea, Doamne, fer că opresc rugăciunea și după aia nu se mai pornește, știți cum e. Tot stăteam și tot mă gândeam, când mă uit la Paul s-a uitat la mine, mă duc lângă el, zic, Paul, I think I want to slow down prayer because I feel like I have to share something. Vreau să împărtășesc ceva. Paul zice, și eu am exact același gând. Ok, am oprit rugăciunea. După ce am împărtășit ce înseamnă botezul cu Duhul Sfânt bazat pe Scriptură, Faptele Apostolilor, capitolul 2, versetul 1-4, după ce am terminat to share this, o întâlnire din cameră a zis, man, Dumnezeu mi-a zis mie să opresc rugăciunea și să zic exact acest lucru. Și am zis, Doamne, nu vreau să opresc rugăciunea, mi-e frică. Și după aia ne povestește, au zis, dacă nu o faci, o să-i spun la Paul și la Eric și ei o să-l oprească. Și exact așa s-a întâmplat. I-am intrat din nou în rugăciune, Domnul l-a botezat. Am foarte multe mărturii de genul ăsta. Deci e o experiență enorm de frumoasă și de bine ca tinerii să se separe de toate lucrurile de toate lucrurile care atât de ușor îi fură atenția și să merg într-un loc unde nu numai la un program sau la o chemare la altar, zi și noapte stau și n-are altceva ce să facă decât să fie la program, decât să-L caute pe Dumnezeu, decât să stea de vorbă cu alți tineri, decât ca noi ca și lideri să ne întâlnim cu ei, să ne rugăm one-on-one, to have small group discipleship. Deci e un lucru enorm de frumos și de bine. And I just want to encourage you about that. I'll be sending more information to Danny, wherever he's at, if that's all right, and to Paul, and then they'll share that with you. În seara aceasta, mesajul va fi pe limba engleză. O să încerc să-l îmbinesc cum știu eu mai bine și sper să nu fie 50% pe românește, 50% pe engleză și 100% încurcat. Deci, my desire is to be faithful, la chemare pe care mi-a pus-o Dumnezeu. Yeah, I work a lot with young people, and for you young people that are here that heard me start off in Romanian and were concerned that this was all going to be in Romanian, it's not. We'll have a good time, all right? And I work a lot with young people. I travel a lot. So what I do is I'm the West Coast Youth Director for the Romanian Church of God Churches, which means I have to visit almost all of them every year, and then I travel to other places that are not Church of God Churches, like together with you guys, and I'm gone very, very, very often. I'm flying home tomorrow morning because the next day I leave to Atlanta. And it's just kind of how my schedule's been. But I spend a lot of time meeting with young people. And one thing that happens often, a misconception that I pick up on that happens very, very often with young people, is we have this mentality that we're going to approach a relationship with the Lord. We're going to come to an altar call. We're going to have some sort of a supernatural mountaintop summit Peniel experience. And that experience is going to bring us to a place where we're going to be good, where we're going to finally arrive. Oftentimes, what I'll see is young people will say, you know, if I could just get over this sin, or if I could just get past this struggle, or if I could just get, you know, baptized with the Holy Spirit, if I could just reach this level, this plane, if I could just get my prayer life under control, if I could, you know, just get my scripture devotional life under control, then I will have arrived. And it's such a wrong conception. It's such a wrong concept. It's such a wrong idea. Because the reality is that when you think you've arrived, you start drifting backwards. There is no arriving in this life. All there is growth. A tree never stands still. It's either growing or it's dying. I can tell you something about every plant in Japan currently right now. All of them are either growing or dying. I don't need to be there to witness it. But everything that's living, that God has created, is either growing or dying. There's no standing still. And when we think that we've arrived, then we end up starting to drift backwards. And it ends up being a very common misconception. I'll see young people, they'll go and they'll have a mountaintop experience, and then afterwards they'll say, you know what, I'm good. And then that's when the coasting begins. And they'll coast for a while, and they'll coast for a while, and then they'll try to put on this facade that everything's fine, and they'll coast for a while, and they'll coast for a while, and then they need another mountaintop experience to rebring them to that position. But that's not God's desire for us. God's desire for every last person here in this place is to be in a continual relationship of growth with Him. You see, when we think that the destination that we're trying to get to is a specific point, we end up failing. It's the journey that we're on. It's the journey that's the destination that we're trying to achieve. It's the journey that we're trying to be in constant relationship with Christ. This is the end goal. This is the end goal. I need to continue growing. I haven't arrived. Brother Luigi Mitsoi needs to continue growing. He'll tell you the same thing. You can pick your favorite preachers and your favorite pastors. They still need to continue growing. Francis Chan and Mark Driscoll or whoever else you want to name. These guys need to continue growing. And they understand this because the necessity isn't for me to obtain. It's for me to let go and to surrender and for God to do what He's doing inside of me. That's where the transformation happens. I want to read for you a specific verse, and I just have to share that in the intro, but I want to read for you a specific verse. Versetul din care vreau să-l citesc e în 1 Corinteni, capitolul 12, de la versetul 12 până la versetul 20. So 1 Corinthians chapter 12, verses 12 through 20. And what we're talking about today is being faithful as Christians. Today's message is for the saved, all right? We're talking about being faithful in God's house and being faithful as sons and daughters. 1 Corinthians chapter 12, starting with verse 12. It says, "For the body is one and has many members. But all the members of that one body, being many, are one body. So also is Christ. For by one Spirit we were all baptized into one body, whether Jews or Greeks, whether slaves or free, and have all been made to drink into one Spirit. For in fact the body is not one member, but many. If the foot should say, because I am not a hand, am I not of the body? Is it therefore not of the body? And if an ear should say, because I am not an eye, I am not of the body, is it therefore not of the body? If the whole body were an eye, where would be the hearing? And if the whole were hearing, where would be the smelling? But now God has set the members, each one of them, in the body just as he pleased. And if they were all one member, where would the body be? But now indeed there are many members, yet one body. So it's important to understand something very, very simple and specific, and that's this. If you are a part of the body, then you're a body part. If you're a part of the body, then you have a specific role. If you're a member in the church, if you're saved, if you're a Christian, then you have a responsibility and a role to play here. In Biserica lui Dumnezeu nu există șomeri. The unemployment rate in the church is zero. Everybody's got a job. And what ends up happening oftentimes is that we end up coming into this mentality. I remember when I was young and I became a Christian, and you know how it was for me when I was young? It was kind of like this. In the Romanian church, this is what I realized. If I don't sing and I don't preach, there's really not much for me to do. That's how I felt. It's not true, but that's how I felt. And I remember getting saved, and I can't sing for the life of me, still can't, never could. I'm learning how to preach, you know, still learning for the last 15 years, and that's all right. But the thing about it is I really could not find a place for myself in the church. And what ended up happening is I started to feel like I didn't have value. I didn't have value. And oftentimes what will happen with young people is that because you feel like you don't have a great voice like so-and-so, or you don't have a preaching ability like your pastor or your youth pastor, or because you don't have a specific unique talent, oftentimes what the enemy will do is he'll come in and he'll convince us that we don't have value. We don't have value in the body. But listen to me, there is no part in the body that doesn't have value. God doesn't make junk. Oftentimes we get into this mentality where we think that, you know what, so-and-so is valuable, and if I had her looks, or if I had his voice, or if I had their preaching ability, or if I had so-and-so's confidence, then I would have value. But the reality is that God doesn't make junk. Everything that God makes is valuable. Every one of you are valuable. You see, there is a unique thing that only you can bring to the church. Look, I preach like I preach, but you're going to preach differently than me. I remember I was hanging out with a friend of mine, and I was talking to a young man. And the way that he conceptualizes things is really weird. He does not connect with most people, all right? And I'm sitting and I'm having this conversation with a young man, and this young man is sharing something with me that I'm not really grasping. But the guy that I was with totally got it. And what would have taken me hours and hours and not have been very fruitful, this guy was able to say in like 30 seconds. You see, there's something unique in your life that you have to bring. You're a part of God's fingerprint that no one else can be. That means that there's something here in this church or whatever church that you're a part of that God wants to use you to bring in uniqueness to where it is that you're serving. And that's beautiful. That's wonderful. Aren't you curious what it is that God has in store for you? Yeah, we allow the enemy to make us think that we're useless. Oftentimes I'll meet with young people, and what will end up happening is they'll say, you know what, Eddie, I would serve, but I have to reach a certain level. Remember we were talking about that, getting to a certain place? You know, only when I'm baptized the Holy Spirit, then God can use me. Or only whenever I get to, you know, Bible college, then God can use me. I was talking to Danny and Chris, actually, a little bit earlier, and they both asked me how I got into youth ministry. And it's a good story, because the way that I got into youth ministry is my previous youth leader resigned. And normally you would assume that if somebody were to call you to take a position in the church, that they would say, hey, listen, I want you to take some time and pray about this and get back to me in a month and we'll go from there. I think I'm tattling on my senior pastor right now. And what happened is Brother Moise called me and he said, hey, Adi, look, I wanted to let you know that I think that you're a good fit for you to take over the youth ministry and so on. And I wasn't expecting that at all. And I was like, okay, when do you need an answer by? And he says, I'm driving to the Comitet meeting right now. And he said, call me back in 5 minutes and give me an answer because I'm almost to church. I was like, all right, great. So I hung up the phone with him and I prayed about it. And then I told him, you know, I'll be an interim youth pastor for like 6 months until you guys find somebody that's more capable. And he didn't bother announcing any of that to the board. They just made me youth pastor and that's it. The funny thing about that is this, is I really felt like I was ill-prepared. I really did. And I remember praying about it in those 5 minutes. And I said, God, I don't have any education. I don't have any training. I don't have any experience. I'm very ninsim not. I'm not important. I don't understand what value I could possibly have to bring to this. I don't have anything. And you know what the Lord said to me? This is what he said. I heard it very clearly. He said, what do you have? And I said, well, I have you. And he said, that's exactly where I want you. That was my experience. He said, that's exactly where I want you. Because if I had experience, I'd rely on experience. If I had education, I'd rely on education. If I had talent, I'd rely on talent. I don't have any of those things. So literally every single day, it was my old youth leader would preach next week. He would preach next week. He would preach the next week. I'm preaching for the next 52 weeks in a row. I'm preaching. Surprise, it just kind of happened overnight. So my entire relationship with the Lord became this. I pray, God spoke, I did. I prayed, God spoke, I did. And it was just a wash, rinse, repeat for the last 15 years. And the more that I pray, the more that I got familiar with his voice. And when he would speak, I would hear, I would understand, and I would do. And then he would come in and miraculously do everything else that I did not have the ability to do. But I thought I wasn't able. I didn't have any abilities. And what's great is that God really isn't interested in our abilities. He isn't interested in our talents. He's interested in our surrender. And when I was able to finally surrender to him, that whole entire thing, he was saying, good, now you get to watch me work. Because that's what he was doing. He was doing it in me and through me. You see, I thought I had to achieve and arrive to a certain place. You think my prayer life was great when I became a youth leader? No, it became real great because I had nothing else going for me. So I had to pray all the time. You think my Bible reading life was great? It wasn't until I became a youth leader. And then I had to read scripture because I had to preach every week. You understand what I'm getting at? You see, I didn't have these things. And the enemy had so convinced me that because I had all of these things in my life that weren't ready yet, that I didn't have any value. But when you make yourself available to the Lord, then God does the supernatural. He doesn't want you to carry his burden. You understand? When there's this famous verse where Jesus asks the disciples, he sits them all down and he says, who do the people say I am? And they said, well, some say that you're a prophet. Some say that you're this or that. And he says, okay, who do you say I am? And Peter kind of pushes everybody aside is how it kind of comes off. And he kind of gets this boldness and he stands up and he says, you're the Christ. And Jesus says, blessed are you, Peter, for flesh and blood did not reveal this to you, but my Father who is in heaven. And then there's that famous verse that we know very well where he says, and you are Peter, and on this rock I will build my church, and the gates of hell will not prevail. We focus so much on that verse about Peter's identity, about the rock, about the gates. But what we miss oftentimes is Jesus says to Peter, you are Peter, and on this rock I will build my church. He builds it, it's his. We miss that. He builds it, it's his. This isn't my church, it's God's church. That ministry that God started using me in, it wasn't my ministry, it was his. It wasn't my job to build it, it was the Lord's. It was mine to surrender, and then he did everything. Because if I built it, then it'd be mine. But it's not my church, it's not your church, it's the Lord's church. He's the one who builds it, and it's his. And the more that we can grasp that, the more that we can understand that, the easier that it'll be for us to be able to surrender and say, you know what, God, I can't, but you can, so therefore you do. You know, oftentimes I hear this verse all the time misquoted. It's 1 Corinthians 10:33. Was it 10:13? No, it's 10:13. Where people misquote it this way, where they say, you know, God won't give you more than you can handle. That's not true. That's not in the Bible. All right, 1 Corinthians 10:13, it says, for no temptation has overtaken you except such as is common to man. And then at the end of it, it says, but with the temptation, God has provided a way of escape that you may be able to bear it. It doesn't say no trial has overtaken you. It says no temptation has overtaken you. You think that God didn't give Peter something he couldn't handle when he asked him to walk on water? That's why Paul says, I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. You know what the reality is? Is God won't give you anything that him living inside of you can't handle. That's the reality. God lives in me. I can't handle it. But whatever he asks me to do, he asks me in his measure to do. Why? Because his call comes with his provisions. His plan comes with his provisions. And as God calls me to serve, he also provides to serve. And then when he says, hey, I want you to step out and to do this great big thing, he's the one who also supplies for that. You know, when I was 27, you know what the church asked me to do? This isn't in my notes. I'm just telling you, this is where I feel led. My background is in architecture in residential. And my church had gotten the blueprint into kind of a situation. And they were like, hey, at 27 years old, do you want to take over this multi-million dollar project? And I thought to myself, I am so unequipped. I'm so unprepared. I'm so untrained. Literally the same thing happened. And I prayed about it because I pray about everything. That's what God's taught me to do. So I'm praying about it. And the Lord says, well, what do you have? I said, I know where this is going. So I said, Lord, if you want me to do it, I'll do it. And then we took on the project. It's been a few years, but we've saved hundreds of thousands of dollars. You think I'm capable of that? Nici vorba. But God always opens doors. When we look to Him, He provides. You know, I went through a very difficult ordeal this last November. Through a very difficult ordeal. And God had allowed everything to get so bad in a situation that I was going through, that finally I was breaking down in prayer in Pennsylvania. I was visiting another church in Pennsylvania, Reading. And I was sitting there, and I was just breaking down, crying, talking to God about the weight that I had on my shoulders. This is not long ago. And I remember this is what I said. I said, God, the fellow Mel, I'm not somebody who comes and prays really for things. I never really have. I don't really pray for cars, or I don't pray for a house or whatever. I usually always pray for spiritual things. This is kind of how I've always been. I usually pray for faith or hope or dedication or wisdom or strength. That's what I usually pray for. But I came to this realization as I'm talking to God. I said, God, I don't usually ask for things, but I'm a son too. And a son can ask things from his father. So if I can ask you for something, I say, God, there's three things that are just killing me right now. And I need, you know, and I'll tell you what they were. I said, you know, God, I financially, I'm having a really hard time making ends meet. Number two, I'd love to go to school, but I can't afford it. And number three, I sure would love to know what's next in ministry. Now, I know better than to put an ultimatum before God. God, if you don't answer me by so-and-so, then I'm going to blah, blah, blah. I know better than that. Even if I said it, I wouldn't believe it. So I'm sitting there and I'm praying this, and I go, God, this is what I'm asking. If I can ask, then I'm asking. And I said, God, I'm not going to put an ultimatum before you because I know better. It's not that if you don't answer me, then I won't. It's that, God, I don't know if I can continue. My commitment to you is excellent. I just don't know if I can continue to execute on that level. And in that evening, the general overseer of all of the Church of God was preaching. He changed around his entire sermon, and it was like he was reading my mail. He was saying, you know, I'm preaching to a brother who's in the middle of a construction project. I mean, he just hit every point. Literally, my senior pastor was two people over, the guy that was next to me. They both stopped and looked at me when he was preaching because they knew this was for me. They knew right away. Since then and until today, God changed everything. Financially, my wife got a considerable raise. We're fine now. We're going to be able to be A-okay. I started my master's degree in January. I know what I'm doing next. He answered all of my prayers. You see, oftentimes we think that we can't ask God for things because we're going to be a burden on Him. But the reality is He wants you to ask because you're sons and daughters. And what it was that He was doing with me, even there, even with the construction project, even with youth ministry, I'm just kind of being really transparent right now, is He wants you to come and ask. He wants you to talk to Him about it. You want to do something in the church? Man, pray about it first. I have young people come to me all the time and they say, Eddie, you know, I'd like to ask for your advice in this situation. And I go, hey, that's great. Did you ask God yet? No? Talk to Him first. Talk to me second. That's the way it should go. Go pray about it. Because the Lord wants to have a relationship with you. So go ask Him and He'll tell you all about it. And that's how we learn to walk with God. God doesn't make junk. If you're a part of the body, then you're a body part. You know, something that hinders us oftentimes is this, is we think that, you know what, my walk with the Lord isn't very good. I'll see people come back from the summit, and their walk with the Lord isn't very good, and they'll start to like grow and maneuver and serve in church, and then they stumble. And the enemy will beat you up so hard when you stumble that he will try to drag you down. But let me ask you something. You know, I have two sons. One's 3 months old, one's 3 years old. And when my firstborn turned one and he started to walk right around then. You know, I would hold his hands and then I would let go and eventually just hold one hand and he was kind of walking and then eventually I let go of his hand. And he took his first step. Me, my wife, somebody was videotaping, everybody was there. The whole household was so excited at the step that he took. So excited. In the ministry that God calls you, it's not going to look great on day one, but I'll tell you, your Heavenly Father, when He's watching you take a step, He's not measuring the distance that you made or the form that you look like. He's excited because my son is walking who wasn't walking before. My daughter is making progress in ministry that she was never making progress in before. No, it's not going to be perfect on day one. But if you continue walking, God in heaven is so proud. He's so excited. He's so celebrating. He's standing around and watching you grow in relationship. And when you stumble, you're going to stumble. And when you stumble, you get back up and you keep on going. And that's what it means to be in ministry. So if you surrender to the Lord, and then what's going to happen is a problem will come and you'll try to take it upon yourself to fix it. No, resurrender it and continue walking. And that's what it means to be in relationship. There are a couple of lies that we believe that I want to look at. There's a couple of lies that we believe that I want to look at. One of them is actually four of them that I want to look at. One of them is, I don't need to be super involved in church. Just attending isn't great, but it's fine. I'll encounter this a lot. People think, you know what, I don't really need to be so involved. If I just attend, it's sufficient. You know, the body, the church, is more than just attending service and being a part of a formatio, which is not a bad thing, it's a good thing. But the church is more than attending service and being a part of a formation, just like a family is more than paying bills and maintaining the house. We can be the forma, but a church is more than that. A church is more than that. A body of believers is more than that. The community of Christ is more than that. It's fellowship with the saints. The church isn't just a place you attend. It's an intimate fellowship you have with brothers and sisters. See, oftentimes we think this. We think, you know what? If I want to get saved, then I need to go to church because that's where you know, people get saved. Look, the church doesn't make Christians. Christ makes Christians. Christians make the church. We can't confuse those things. It's Jesus that made us, that saved us, not this place. It's Jesus that saves people, and he's the one who makes Christians. It's Christians who make the church. The church doesn't make us, we make it. And the more that we can understand that, the better off that we're going to be. See, oftentimes we think that, you know what, if I just have a minimalistic involvement because I don't really have talent or I don't really have gifting, you know, other people, let them be in front and so on. The more that we think that, the more that we're going to hinder God's ability to be able to invest and grow the church. You know, I really enjoyed that the young couple that was up here this morning. And I really enjoyed them, the song that they sang. You know, the one that says, I fost răstignit și cu ele îmi spun ce mare ți-a fost iubirea. Atât de mult îmi place cântarea aia. Și să vă spun de ce. Taică meu face tot felul de construcții, especially in the past, și e un zugrav foarte bun. And zugrăvea la cineva o casă and a trebuit să vopsește într-un loc să meciuiește culoarea. Era cam așa un beige. Și are un ochi foarte bun de a meciui culorile. Și l-a vopsit și nu se vedea nimica. Era gata geabul. A intrat clientul înăuntru, John Mohamed îl cheamă. And a intrat clientul înăuntru și zice, oh, Alex, arată bine, dar de ce nu e aceeași culoare? Taică meu s-a uitat, zice, dar cum, John, de nu e aceeași culoare? It looks exactly the same, arată exact la fel. John zice, uite, hai aici aproape. Și uite, zice, uite, vezi aici marginea vopseaua care l-ai vopsit tu. Și dacă m-a întrebat, zice, eu nu l-am văzut. Cum de l-ai văzut? El a zis, I'm colorblind. Deci eu nu văd culori. Eu văd numai negru și alb. Între un fel de beige și alt fel de beige, maybe nu se vede, zice el. Dar între gri și gri se vede destul de bine. Eu n-am niciun talent de muzică. Încercam să învăț chitara într-o zi și a venit Dan Muncaciu, directorul nostru de muzică pe atunci, pus mâna lui pe umăr, zice, știi ce, Harry, fiecare cu darul lui. Thanks, Dan. Deci eu n-am ureche deloc, pentru for sound. I'm tone deaf. And când cântă cineva și își folosește talentul, eu nu pot să pricep. Dar când văd într-o persoană o inimă care se închină lui Dumnezeu, aia pot să văd foarte clar. Și atât de mult iubesc oameni care vin înainte lui Dumnezeu și are inimă curată, care vrea să-L laudă pe Dumnezeu. Țin minte, într-o seară, era o fată neînsemnată la noi la biserică, nu prea băgată în seamă. Era ea mai nouă la credință. And s-a făcut o cântare, colectă și după aia s-a așezat lumea jos. Și știți cum e când ne așezăm jos? Unele ori mai încep să discuți, mai încep să, mai stai de vorbă cu persoana lângă tine. A venit fata aia pe scenă, nu prea a băgat-o nimeni în minte. Și țin minte, stăteam cam acolo la noi la biserică și eu eram cu ochii pe ea, că știam că viața ea era sub puterea lui Dumnezeu. Și țin minte, auzeam un gălăgie, cum vorbea lumea în biserică, și a început să cânte o cântare care zice, Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty. Deci, sfânt, sfânt, sfânt e Dumnezeu atotputernic. Și nu o să uit niciodată, a început să cântă, nu avea o voce deosebită, dar a început să cântă cu atât de multă putere și pasiune și predare înainte lui Dumnezeu, că dintr-o dată s-a simțit prezența lui Dumnezeu în sală, toată lumea în spatele meu a tăcut din gură și tot s-a plecat și eu știu că era prezența lui Dumnezeu în acel loc. Dorința mea este să văd într-o zi o orchestră care cântă în biserică, să fie un zgomot în biserică că cântă orchestra. Și când cântă o orchestră să fie atât de plin de Duhul Sfânt, ca să ne închide la toată lumea gura, și a mea și lui toți, să stăm și să zicem, acum suntem în prezența lui Dumnezeu. Talentul, de multe ori, ne ascundem după el sau credem că ne trebuie un talent și adevărul este că sfințenia inimii dă valoare talentul. Dacă avem o inimă curată și sfântă și avem un talent mic, Dumnezeu poate să face lucruri mari cu acest lucru. Dacă avem o inimă sfântă și predată înaintea lui Dumnezeu și avem un talent mai mare, și mai mult poate să face Dumnezeu. El nu este impresionat de talentele noastre, că de fapt El ni le-a dat. Dacă talentul singur îi dă laudă lui Dumnezeu și îl onorează, păi ăștia din lume are mai bune talente decât noi. El este onorat de cineva lumesc care are un talent frumos? Nici de cum. De-aia trebuie să ne apropiem de El la un nivel de inimă. Ne gândim de multe ori, we think a lot of times that we don't need to be super involved in church, that attending is just fine, but you need to be intimately involved in service. You need to be intimately committed to service. This isn't a place we attend and a rehearsal that we practice at. We want to be a part of this family and this relationship with Christ. Another lie that we believe is that we don't need fellowship. Another lie that we believe is that we don't really need fellowship. I know that we're Romanian, and as a Romanian, we love community and fellowship, but sometimes what ends up happening is we have people that fall by the wayside. After service, everybody's in their own little cliques and their groups, and there's some people that are not. And then they just kind of think, you know what, I'm not really going to have fellowship, and it's okay. If I have good teaching, I can watch online at home. I don't really need to be a part of all of this. Look, no organ survives outside of the body. The devil's plan has always been the same. It's divide and conquer. Planul celui rău oricând a fost la fel. Care este diavolul, când se apropie de turmă, este să ia una, să o separe de restul și pe aia o prinde. The enemy's plan has always been the same, divide and conquer. Look, I love the Lord, all right? I pursue God, I'm passionate about God. I every single day, my work is ministry. This is what I do full time, all right? And sometimes, as much as I want to hear from the Lord, sometimes I'm either too stubborn or I'm too rebellious or I'm too sinful or I'm too broken or I'm too occupied that I don't hear from the Lord when he's trying to speak to me. And what I need is I need what David needed, a Nathan in my life that can come into my life and say, hey, listen, I love you, man. You're my brother. I know what you believe. And right now what you're practicing doesn't match what you believe. Somebody who can just step out into my life and I can be vulnerable with them and they can hold me accountable. Oftentimes we think that we don't need fellowship, but if you look at the first church in Acts in chapter 2, and right after verse 41, it talks about this fellowship and this intimacy that the brothers had in the first church. That's the kind of relationship that has to exist. It's a lie if we believe that we don't need to be a part of the body. No organ survives outside of it. Another lie that we believe is that we are no longer sons and daughters, but that we are employees. This is so important. For years, I believed that God saved me so I could produce for him. An de zile am crezut că Dumnezeu m-a mântuit ca eu să pot să produc ceva pentru el. Dacă el m-a mântuit ca numai ca eu să produc ceva, înseamnă că nu sunt fiu, înseamnă că sunt angajat. Și dacă eu sunt un angajat, sau dacă noi suntem numai angajați, avem cea mai rea firmă de pe lume. Gândiți-vă, dacă un șef de-a vostru vă zice să faceți un lucru și zici, o fac mâine, o fac poimâine, maybe nu o fac, vă dă afară, sau pe mine sau pe voi, nu-i așa? Dar cu Dumnezeu acceptăm treaba asta. Deci nu e o firmă, e o familie. Am un prieten bun înapoi în Sacramento, un om pe care îl iubesc, un frate. Nu-i mai zic numele. He's a good man. And el are mai mulți copii. El avea la el acasă, când era în România, acum în Sacramento, avea un atelier în spate unde făcea curele. Și fiecare copil i-a dat o slujbă. La unul era să taie pielea, la altul era să pune the belt buckle, la altul era să facă găurile, and so on. La fetița cea mai mică, ea a fost controlul, quality control, să fie sigur că tot e ok. el când lucra cu copiii lui, făcea maybe 5 curele într-o oră, o oră jumate. Când lucra singur, făcea vreo 50. Ați lucrat vreodată cu copiii voștri, așa mai mici, ai pus la lucru la ceva. Ideea e foarte simplă. De multe ori noi ne gândim că Dumnezeu m-a mântuit și din pricina asta eu trebuie să produc pentru El. Parcă este ceva care eu o să produc, care Dumnezeu n-a putut să produce mai bine. Gândiți-vă la treaba asta. Eu de multe ori mă gândesc că Dumnezeu, Tu m-ai mântuit ca eu să produc ceva pentru Tine. Dar adevărul este că tot ce există în viața mea este să produce nu ceva prin mine, ci să produce caracteristicile lui Dumnezeu în mine. I'm the point for the Lord. And that's crazy to think about. You see, oftentimes we think that the Lord saved us so we can produce for Him, so you can sing, so you can practice, so you can be a witness, so that way you can share the gospel and so on. And the reality is that the reason why the Lord saved us isn't so we could produce something for Him, but it's so He could produce His image in us. The end goal of my friend who's a pastor wasn't to sit there and produce a lot of belts with his kids. It was to produce character in them. It was to produce discipline in them. It was to produce an understanding of teamwork in them. They were the goal. They were the point. Jesus didn't die on the cross so that way He can build a factory that I can work for. He already has employees. The angels, they're perfect. They're the perfect employees. He didn't die for them. He died for sons and daughters. He didn't die for employees. He died for us to be able to be a part of His family. In Romans chapter 8, verse 20, it says something very, very, very fantastic. It says, all things work together for the good of those who are in Christ Jesus, who are called according to a purpose. All things work together for the good of those who are in Christ Jesus. All things work together for the good. Define good. Me getting a new BMW. That sounds pretty good. Is that what Jesus is talking about? No. You go to verse 29 and it says, for whom He foreknew, He predestined to what? To be made into the image of His Son. That's what it's talking about. It says, for all things work together for the good. The good that Paul's talking about there is being made into the image of Jesus. That means that everything that you have in your life is working together to make you like Jesus. Everything. Do you think that God's up in heaven, if you feel like God called you to be a nurse, you think God's up in heaven and He's like, oh man, I really hope that, you know, so-and-so becomes a nurse because we have a lack of nurses. He's the divine healer. He doesn't need me. He doesn't need you. Oh, I really hope we have more doctors. Wow, you know, earth is running low on their accountants. Census, you know, that doesn't happen. I mean, think about it. If God really wanted you to be a doctor tomorrow, couldn't He just, and you're a doctor in papers and degree and everything else, then why does He do it the way that He does it? Because you're in school. You're in school to learn how to be made more into the image of His Son. The exams that you take, you know what that has to do with? That has to do with you being more like Christ. You know, the homework that you have, the way that you treat your parents, the work that you do, the job that you have, all of that is ways that God is using. You think that my friend who's a pastor working with his kids is about making belts? It wasn't about making, he can make more belts on his own. It was about developing character in his children. And that's what it's about for us as well. So whatever you've got going on in your life, understand that Jesus didn't save you for you to be an employee. He saved you to be a son and a daughter, and the very things in your life are the things that He's using to mold you and make you into His image. It's a different approach that you take to school when you realize that. It's a different approach that you take to work. It's a different approach that you take to the way that you drive on the street. Everything is an opportunity for the Lord to speak into your life and to grow some part of your life. And I'll tell you, when my wife realized that, she had this realization quite a few years back now. She was in the middle of nursing school, and when she had that realization, she said, Eddie, tests used to be so stressful for me, and school used to be so stressful for me. And from that point on, it wasn't a stress anymore because she understood why she was in school. It was to be more like Jesus. And she would just surrender those things, and all of her exams went really easy. She got much better grades than she did before. She was doing really well in all of her classes. And it's important to understand that the reason why God calls us to go through certain places is because it's us that He wants to develop into His image. Fourth myth or lie that we tell ourselves is that it's the church's entire job to feed me. It's the church's entire job to feed me. We think that the church makes Christians, it's Christians that make the church, and it's Christ that makes Christians. The church isn't some place you attend, it's an intimate fellowship to have with your brothers and sisters, right? We talked about this. You know, I'll have young people tell me that, you know, I really like going to this church or to that church because every time I'm there, I'm on fire. Man, every time I go there, I get so fed. You know what it's like being on fire in a really powerful church? It's not that impressive, honestly. It's like being full when you're spoon-fed. You didn't do anything. You just showed up. That's like saying, man, I light up really bright when I'm in a room full of lights. You see what I'm getting at? The question is, are you relying on a relationship with the Lord that isn't dependent on other people? In Colossians chapter 1, verse 27, it says, and this is the mystery that's hidden from the ages and the generations, which is Christ in you, the hope of glory. So in Colossians 1, 27, it says that Christ lives in us. You know what I find strange? And total proof of it is this, is whenever we have a guest visitor, like Pastor Luigi or Brother Lazar Gog or whoever, you know, Francis Chan or whoever you want, okay? We pack our churches, don't we? Man, we pack them wall to wall. Oh, did you hear that Brother So-and-so is coming? And everybody fills the auditorium. And what I find strange is this, is I'll be sitting in the audience and I'll go to a place because I really want to hear Francis Chan speak or whoever. And the message that that preacher has is powerful not because of him, but because of Christ who lives in me. It seems kind of redundant that I need to go to hear from another person what Jesus who lives in me is saying. They seem kind of unnecessary in this scenario, don't they? Why don't I just talk to the Lord? He lives in me. His message to me, he who lives in me, isn't going to be general like the preachers. It's going to be specific. It's going to be specific to me. You see, the challenge there is to be able to draw near to the Lord and to be able to hear his voice. The job of the entire church isn't to feed everybody who shows up, or else we're going to have a bunch of toddlers that are constantly getting spoon-fed. The job of each one of us is to draw near to the Lord, to hear his voice, and to let him work in us and then through us. That's the goal. It's a lie if we think that, you know, I got to go find a really good church that, you know, is going to constantly feed me. I was sitting down and I was having a conversation with my cousin and with his wife, who I hope still likes me. And she said, oh, you know, they were engaged at the time. They're married now. You know, they're like, oh, you know, we're going to get married in a couple of months and we're just church shopping. I hate that phrase. All right. They said, we're church shopping. And I said to myself, behave. Don't say anything. You don't know her. She doesn't know who you are and the conversation, how this is going to go. She said it a second time. And I said to myself again, Eddie, shut up. Don't say anything. Okay. She said it a third time. And now my putut. And I asked, I said, hey, so what determines where you should go to church? And she said, well, you know, where you get fed, where you feel like you're getting fed. And that sounds like a fair answer. Except Isaiah wouldn't agree, Jeremiah wouldn't agree, Paul wouldn't agree, Peter at times wouldn't agree. Like, I can go on and on. Jeremiah, we already did Jeremiah, Jonah wouldn't agree. You see what I'm getting at? The point of the church isn't me, it's Christ. It's Christ. Okay, the question isn't, God, where do I go because I want to feel comfortable and be fed? The question is, God, where do you want me to go? All right, let me ask you this. If your church closed up, would you still have a relationship with Jesus? If that famous pastor wasn't preaching anymore and he left and he moved to another church, would you still have a relationship with Jesus? Or is it reliant on some other qualifier between you and the Lord? If it does, and that's okay if it does currently, I just want to challenge you. Work on removing anything between you and the Lord and have a direct relationship with him. That's what God's calling us to have. You see, I when I gave my life to the Lord, I gave it to him on condition, which is weird. I don't know any better. I was young, all right? But I said, Lord, if you want my life, I'll give you all of my life, but on two conditions. That's what I said. I was 16, all right? I don't know any better, all right? So I said, I'll give it to you on two conditions. Number one, if I become a Christian and I give you my life, then if I'm in, I'm in. Like, don't use me to bring you a little bit of glory. I want you to use me to bring you a lot of glory. Like, I am in. And number two, if you want me, then I said, God, give me a job that no one else wants. If there's like a garbage man in Christianity, give me that. Okay, that's where I want to go. That's what I want to do. I want to do what nobody else wants. Because if I'm going to live the rest of my life, man, I'm going to go for broke. Like, I'm all in or I'm not in at all. The Vikings, whenever they arrived to England, you know what they would do? They would land, they would unload their boat, they would unload the people, they would unload all of the gear out of the boat, and then they would set fires to their boat, to their boats. They would set all of their boats on fire. Google it. They would set fire to their boats because this was now home. They're either, you're going to make it or you're going to die, and that was their options. They had no way back. They were committed. We got too many Christians that leave half of their gear still in the boat just in case as a plan B backup. But the reality is that God is calling us to be able to have an intimate relationship with him and to break all bridges to the past and say, you know what, God, if I'm in, I'm in, and I'm in all the way. And when we live that kind of a relationship, it isn't dependent on, you know, if so-and-so preaches well or not. It's dependent on your personal relationship with Christ. A lot of times we'll have altar calls and young people will stand up and they'll say, well, I want to be a missionary in Africa. And God's thinking, how can I send you to Africa if I can't send you to your bedroom to pray at the edge of your bed? You're going to be faithful in the little, and then we get to faithful in the large. And that's really the big thing that I want to encourage you guys into understanding. The lie that we believe is that it's the church's job to feed me and for me to be comfortable in service. It's not. It's your job to hear from the Lord and to walk in relationship with Him, because that's what He ultimately wants. So lastly, I want to just cover two things in the next 6 to 8 minutes. Two things. One is practical and life application, but the first one is about desiring God. So you want to desire God and you want to grow in relationship with Him. James chapter 4 verse 8 says, draw near to me and I will draw near to thee. You know how easy it is to draw near to the Lord? You know how easy it is? We think it's complicated, that it's difficult. I remember an American lady that I was talking to about being baptized with the Holy Spirit, and I asked her, I said, you know, I've been trying for like 4 years, and then I just said, I'm not going to try anymore for 3 more years. So for 7 years, I haven't been baptized, but I want to be baptized with the Holy Spirit. You know, and I don't know. And she looks at me, this American lady, she goes, oh, you Romanians, you make everything so complicated. That's what she said to me. It's a true story. I was in Munzi, Arjish, and Timișoara. This lady was visiting, and that's what she said. And then we talked about the baptism of the Holy Spirit, and like 8 minutes later, I was baptized the Holy Spirit. Drawing near to God is not complicated. Watch, I'll explain it to you, and you'll realize, wow, that was really easy. Imagine, young men, the most perfect woman you could ever imagine. Like your dream gal. Ladies, do the opposite, right? Imagine the most perfect, I mean, they're funny. They're great. They're attractive. They're super godly. Whatever they say out of their mouth is just like it's super wise. It's very, very intelligent, and they're interested in you. How much time would you have to spend with that person to fall in love with them? Pretty short amount of time. Jesus is better than that. All you got to do is spend time with them, and I guarantee you, you'll fall in love with the Lord. You spend time with the Lord, you'll fall in love with Him. You know, if I took a photo and I showed it to you and of somebody that looks like a great person, you'd look at it and it would be one level of interest. If I told you a story, man, this guy, he did these amazing things and God used him in these amazing ways and so on, you would be much more interested in that person. But if you met them and they were amazing, you would be much more interested in that person. It's one thing to be able to hear about the Lord. How much growth and desire happens in your heart whenever you hear a powerful testimony of something that God did. It draws you near to the Lord. How much more when you spend time with Him? It's not complicated. You just got to be sincere before Him. We complicate everything to death. We start to pray all of these fancy prayers instead of just being sincere before Him and saying, God, here's what I got on my heart. Listen, if you want to draw near to God, if you want to draw near to God, it starts in sincerity, like I was talking about this morning. It's not complicated. If you want to draw near to God, be sincere and say, Lord, I want to draw near to you. If you don't want to draw near to God, but you wish you did, be sincere on that level. God, I don't really have a desire for you, but God, I wish I did. He'll meet you even there. You can take that as far as you want if you don't even have that, but you wished you had a desire to have a desire. You know what I mean? Like, you can go all the way down as far as you want to go with this. But the point is if you're willing to be sincere before the Lord, God will meet you where you're at. That's it. It's not complicated. Come before the Lord and talk to Him about whatever you have on your heart. Are you in business? Have you asked Jesus about that? Are you looking for a wife? Have you talked to the Lord about that? Are you interested in something maybe not nearly as life-changing? You want to buy a car. Have you talked to the Lord about it? Talk to Jesus about it. You would be surprised in the ways that He answers. I remember when I wasn't a Christian, I was at the camp. I was maybe 3 days before I gave my life to the Lord. I was walking around and all of my Romanian friends had left. So it was just me by myself and a bunch of Americans. And I thought to myself, I don't know anyone here, but they're all Christian and I'm not. So I'm just going to say hi to people, and they have to say hi to me because they're super polite. And sure enough, they did. And then I just made friends because I just chose, we're going to be friends. And that happened. And I remember I made some friends with some people that were not good people there at the camp. And they were all, I was outside and I was walking in, and they were like you can imagine here somewhere in a hallway or whatever. And there was a little window through that doorway so you could see inside, like, you know, they have those little windows. And I started walking and I thought to myself, at that time I didn't believe in the Lord anymore. I had gotten into a lot of trouble. I got in trouble with the law, with a lot of things. And I remember I didn't believe in the Lord. And I'm sitting here and I'm saying, thinking in my head, I was like, you know what? I don't believe that there is a God. But God, if you're real, and I thought I'd put him la colse. And I said, if you're real, before I get to that door, I was walking from the outside in. Let me see somebody that I know, but not like that I kind of know, like that I really know well. And I knew that all of my friends had left. There was no one left at the camp that I knew. And I thought to myself, if you're really real, do something miraculous. And I walk over to the door, and I come up to the window, and all my those bad friends of mine are in here. And I said, God, if you show me that, I won't hang out with these people today because we're going to go do some things that were not okay. And you know what happened when I got to the door? And I got to that window. You know who I saw? I saw my reflection. And I thought to myself, who do I know better than myself? And I kind of chuckled to myself, and I said, I still don't believe in you. And then I turned around and I walked away. But the fact that it opened me up into a conversation with the Lord, man, 3 or 4 days later, I met the Lord. Like, I met Christ, and he transformed me. All right? My point is do you think that God is incapable of speaking to you in a way that you can understand? No, of course he can. He can talk to you in a way that you can understand. It's not going to look like mine. It's not going to be, oh, I heard the audible voice of God. I've never heard the audible voice of God, but he speaks into my heart clear as day oftentimes. You understand what I'm saying? He's more than capable of speaking to you, but you just got to ask and you got to be open. And then lastly, I just wanted to give you guys some examples. In 1 Peter chapter 5, verse 8, it says, be sober-minded and be vigilant because your adversary, the devil, walks around like a roaring lion seeking whom he may devour. Be sober-minded means don't be distracted. Be vigilant means be watchful. In Galatians chapter 5, verse 6, it says, the only thing that counts is faith expressing itself through love. And I just want to give you some practical application about drawing near to the Lord. All right? Number one, don't set I'm going to pray for an hour every day until I die. You're going to do it for like 4 days, and then it's not going to happen anymore. And then you're going to feel really guilty about it, and then you're not going to make any more commitments. All right? I'm just being brutally honest if I can do that. All right? Instead, be really sincere before the Lord. And I just want to encourage you, if you spend no time with the Lord in the morning, man, I just encourage you, take 5 minutes, take 10 minutes, take 15 minutes, and say, you know what, Lord, I'm just going to spend a couple of minutes with you in the morning, and be sincere, and don't hold yourself to a timer. Just draw near to him, and I'll tell you, when you start your morning with the Lord, try it for 3 days. Start your morning with the Lord. See what your day looks like. It'll be tremendously different. It will, and if you've experienced that, you know exactly what I'm talking about. You can spend time meditating on a single verse. You can seek extended solitude. Be still and listen to God. Don't pray. Just be quiet and listen until you eventually learn how to hear his voice. You know, in John chapter 10, it says, the sheep follow me for they know my voice. For they know my voice. Learn to discern God's voice. It's not complicated. You just spend time quietly and you pray and then you stop praying and you listen and you don't listen with your ears, you listen with your heart. And then if God says something to you, then you put it to a test. And then if it ends up working out, then you know, okay, this is the Lord, and you keep on walking in that manner. Pray through passages of scripture. Personalize it for you or for a friend. Sing if you can sing. Write your prayers to God in a journal, but just be aware, if you're writing prayers in a journal, I wouldn't make them super specific. Somebody will find it. I guarantee it happens all the time. Write down what life lessons you've learned recently and come back. Journal. I have a friend of mine and a lot of friends, actually, who journal all the time. And they'll just journal out everything on their heart. And what's great about journaling is this. Is when you're in the moment, you're not 100%. You're 100% focused on the moment, but you're not 100% focused on what's outside. And you'll write all this stuff down out of your heart. And tomorrow you'll forget about it. And then the next day you'll write new things and you'll forget about it. But if you look back over like the last month of your life or the last 3 weeks of your life, you'll see a reoccurring theme, and you'll realize things about yourself that you never realized. I have a friend that is extremely negative, extremely negative. Whatever you say, he will find what's wrong with it. Doesn't matter. You know, hey, Jesus is coming. Yeah, but he didn't come today. You know, I mean, just always negative, right? And we've tried to, like, hint at it, and just for years we've been bringing this up. I won't tell you his name. He's a good friend of mine. No, I'll tell you his name. His name's Jonathan, right? So Jonathan comes to me, and he started journaling a lot. He comes to me, and we're in discipleship together, and he comes to me 2 weeks ago, and he's like, Eddie, I'm really negative. And I was like, really? I'm so glad you know. How did you know that? And he explained, journaling. I was able to see all of what's in my heart out for a longer period of time than 5 minutes. So journaling is extremely valuable. Anyways, That's really what I had on my heart. You know, if you have a gift that's unique to you, God doesn't make junk. So be involved. Get involved in the church. Commit to an involved life in the church. Your sin doesn't cost more than the price that Christ paid, because ultimately what God desires to do is to use all of us. It's not about your abilities. It's about your availability. The body is more than attending service and being part of a formation, like marriage is more than paying bills and maintaining a house. So you want to get involved in church. You need fellowship. Don't separate from the body and be out on your own, but you need fellowship so other people can speak into your life. We are sons and daughters. We're not employees. Remember, what God is working on is producing you. You're his end goal, to produce you, to be made into the image of his son. And then ultimately, as you're the image of his son, what do? You become lights into darkness automatically. You don't go out into the darkness because you have a duty and a responsibility. You go out into the darkness because you're a light shining bright and you love to go pursue the lost, because that's what Jesus did. So we're made into his image. The church doesn't make Christians. Christians make the church. It's Christ that makes Christians. So have a healthy devotional life and make sure that you're feeding yourself. Remember, it's easy to stay on fire whenever you're being spoon-fed. So pursue a personal relationship with Jesus Christ that isn't dependent on a preacher, on a singer, on a speaker, or a church, or whatever. But pursue a relationship with the Lord. Growth comes in obedience. Draw near to God and he will draw near to you. Spend time with him and you'll fall in love with him in whatever ways that the Lord leads you on. Pioneer, be adventurous. And I love you guys, and I desire God to do great things in this church. Thank you.